तद्धर्मज्ञ
महाभागा
भवद्वीर गौरवं कुलम् वृजीनं नार्हति प्राप्तुम् पूज्यं वंद्यम अभीक्ष्णशः. वर्ड टू वर्ड मीनिंग एंड ट्रांसलेशन. तद् देयरफॉर धर्मज्ञ. One who is aware of the principles of religion, Mahabhaga, the most fortunate, Bhavadbihi, by a good self, Gauravam, glorified, Kulam, the family, Vrijinam, that which is painful, Na, not, Arhati, does deserve, praptum, for obtaining, pujyam, the worshipable, vandyam, respectable, abhishnashah, constantly. Translation and purport by His Divine Grace, Shri A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Srila Prabhupada. O most fortunate one, who knows the principles of religion, it is not good for you to cause grief to glorious family members who are always respectable and worshipful. Purport: a slight insult for a respectable family is sufficient to invoke grief. Therefore, a cultured man should always be careful in dealing with worshipful family members. Hare Krishna. So we welcome all devotees to our Sunday morning Bhagavatam class. It's nice to see devotees coming in good numbers after the lockdown has been lifted. We are reading a section in the Srimad Bhagavatam where there is dealing with confusion and contradictory instructions. All of us go through that in life. So this is a very relevant section for us. Ashwatthama has performed a very most heinous and barbaric act of terrorism. He is like one of the worst terrorist acts. 5 sleeping sons of Draupadi were mercilessly killed by Ashwatthama in the night. And Draupadi began to lament. And Arjuna was to get the killer back and give justice and take revenge and to kill the perpetrator of this crime. Finally, Krishna and Arjuna go searching and Arjuna arrests Ashwatthama. And that time, Lord Krishna tells Arjuna to kill Ashwatthama. Krishna supports killing of Ashwatthama because he killed Draupadi's 5 sons. So Krishna says, he killed Draupadi's 5 sons, you should kill him. He is cruel. And you promised Draupadi that you will kill the killer of your Draupadi's sons. So kill him immediately. So this is what Krishna tells Arjuna. Now in spite of Krishna's encouragement, Arjuna did not like the idea. This is interesting. You know, we always quote Bhagavad Gita 18.66. where Krishna says, surrender everything, just do what I say, sarvadharman parityajya. And here Arjuna is not doing. So then what does Arjuna do then? He drags Ashwatthama to the military camp and he entrusts him to Draupadi. And now this section we are reading from last 2 days, we have this section where Draupadi's Vama Swabhava or mild and gentle nature is coming out. Now this is the most amazing section where Draupadi has lost her 5 sons and now she is displaying unparalleled forgiveness and gentleness and kindness. Like yesterday, Satyanand Prabhu very graphically contrasted Draupadi's forgiveness with our own day-to-day inability to forgive. He was giving the example of his base where they struggled. So here we see Draupadi is the perfect example of empathy. Understanding what Ashwatthama's mother will go through if Ashwatthama is killed. Because she has lost her 5 sons. Draupadi has lost her 5 sons. So she is saying Kripi, who is the mother of Ashwatthama, will also go through a lot of pain. So as she tells Arjuna not to kill Ashwatthama, Yudhishthira and Arjuna agree with her. Bhima and Krishna disagree. And then Arjuna looks at Krishna for help. Confusion, contradiction, because there are scriptural quotations for both actions. So then Krishna, what does he say? He gives equivocal instructions. Remember, I said equivocal, not unequivocal. Unequivocal matlab clear. Black and white. Ye karo, ye mat karo. Equivocal means an instruction which is open to more than one interpretation. So have you gone through in life where you get some instruction which is open to more than one interpretation? So that's what Arjuna got. Krishna said, Arjuna, you should follow what Draupadi and Yudhishthira are saying. It's very important. And Bhima is also right. So you do. And Krishna smiles. So now Arjuna expertly resolves this. And what does Arjuna do? For that, you'll have to attend future classes or hear what Arjuna, or read the Bhagavatam. But Srila Prabhupada emphatically writes in this section how Arjuna resolves this, when Arjuna resolves this confusion. Prabhupada writes 2 very powerful statements. One, he says, contradictory orders are impossible to carry out. Right? So what is the solution? So Srila Prabhupada writes the second statement. What Arjuna did, Arjuna selected a compromise. Therefore, compromise seems inevitable when dealing with contradictions of material life. Srila Prabhupada is saying how when there are contradictions, this compromise has to be followed. And we see this is very practical because in life we have to compromise many times. So at such times, what did Arjuna do? That we have to do. Arjuna used his own intelligence to understand what is the Lord's motive, and that helped him come out of bewilderment. So 2 things, very, very important. First is using our own intelligence. But second, understanding what is the Lord's desire. So generally, when we read scriptures or when we do some things, we use our intelligence. But when we use our intelligence, we are generally thinking in terms of my well-being, my welfare, my comfort. We have to use our intelligence like Arjuna did. But second is very important. What does Krishna want? So when we constantly pray, Krishna, Radha Gopinath, please reveal to me what is your desire. Please guide me. I am an instrument in your hand. I am a puppet. Please guide me, Krishna. And in that dependence, when we use our intelligence like Arjuna did, then we can come out of bewilderment and confusions created by contradictory instructions. That is the essence of this pastime, this section. Is that clear? So now we will continue to elaborate on this. See, what happens when we are new in bhakti, things are very easy. You know, just do what people tell us to, authorities tell us to do. But later on, as we get older or we get more responsibility, we have to decide individually. Because the authorities may say both are okay. This is also okay. That is also okay. For that time, these 2 principles which Arjuna followed, we have to follow. What is the first principle? Use our own intelligence. And what is the second principle? What is Krishna's desire? That should be our meditation. Because life is not black and white. Life has many gray shades. All of you agree? And we have a journey through this gray shade. And we have to individually decide what I have to do, what I cannot do. You know, when we are new in bhakti, we find Krishna consciousness very attractive because things are presented to us as black and white. Prabhupada gave us very specific things. Don't do this, do this. But as we get older, we realize, oh, it's not like that. I remember when I was young, I was around 23, 24. I realized life is very complicated. I began to realize life is getting complicated and there are a lot of gray shades. And I didn't want to deal with this complexities. And Krishna consciousness appeared attractive because of many reasons. And one of the reasons it was attractive was because there was no confusion. So I thought it is very easy, black and white, simple. No, but after talking to so many senior disciples of Srila Prabhupada, we realize how life has a lot of gray shades. And as we get older, we realize that it's not so simple and straightforward. Krishna consciousness process is simple, but material energy is not simple. Material energy is very complicated, isn't it? I'll give a simple example. When I was a new devotee, I just joined the temple. I got the service of serving prasadam on Sunday feast program. I was prasadam in charge. So devotees would do a lot of kirtan and all the prasadam of Sunday feast would be served in Lakshmi Narayan garden. So I would be serving and then some devotees would dance for a long time. Kirtan would go on for long and other devotees would come for prasadam. For the sweet rice, kheer, that would get over. Because the devotees were taking prasad, they would come for second helping. And I gave them. And when the devotees who finished the kirtan came down and there was no sweet, they said, "Kya Prabhuji, amare liye rakha nahi?" And one devotee came and said, "Prabhuji, this is an offense. Huh? You are not keeping sweet rice for devotees." I said, "Offense? We are all afraid of aparad. We don't want to do aparad." So I got alarmed. And next Sunday when I was serving prasadam, and these devotees came, "Prabhuji, second round." I said, "Nahi milega, ek hi bar. Sweet ek hi bar." Because there are devotees upstairs. But then they said, "Nahi Prabhuji, dona, they are happy. Everybody gets what they want. They want kirtan, they are getting kirtan. We want sweet rice, give us sweet rice, ma'am." I said, "No, only one round." And they were very upset. And one devotee came and said, "Prabhuji, this is an offense. You are not giving Mahaprasad." So I went to the senior leader of our temple and I said, "What to do? If this is an offense, if I don't give Mahaprasad, sweet rice, when the devotees are asking for second round?" And he said, "Yes, it is an offense." And then I said, "But if I give, then the devotees are coming after kirtan, they don't get. Is an offense? If it is an offense to them, then that is an offense. And what should I do? You decide." And then I had to use my intelligence. I had to pray. What is the best thing? Guide me, Krishna. And then I got the intelligence that next Sunday when they would come for second round, I would smile at them. I would give one little bit of the sweet. And I would just do some appeasing them like that. Anyway, that issue got resolved. But it's a way we learn in life that things are not simply black and white. And as we learn to make the right choices, we slip. And Srila Prabhupada is reminding in today's purport also that how, a cultured man, he's talking about two principles, cultured, being cultured and sensitive, especially in household life. Here, the context is household life, but it applies to brahmachari, sannyasis, everyone. That especially when dealing with family members, there has to be sensitivity and culture. Because life is not simply black and white. You can't say, "We decided like this, you should do this, you should not do that." I remember once somebody was just talking about, "This is wrong, this is right." It became intense, the discussion. So I told him that there is, I told him in Hindi, "Sahi aur galat ke pare bhi ek jagah hai. Aap vahan mujhe milenge toh main baat karunga." Beyond right and wrong, there is a place. Can we meet there? Can we understand what you're going through, what I'm going through? Can we empathize? Because in household life, this is the context, there is a lot of compromise. Now, let me clarify. Compromise is not the foundation of household life. Dedication and commitment is the foundation of every ashram. But this dedication and commitment takes many forms. And one of the forms it takes is compromise. Which is unfortunate. You can't say unfortunate. It is a part of the purification. And because we are dealing with the material energy, and we have to learn to adjust. And that time we have to rack our brains. And Srila Prabhupada is revealing here, being cultured, sensitive. It's very important. But sometimes what happens is we miss the point. Many times in the renounced order, we miss the point because, we don't deal with this real issues many times. And we may be in our own imaginary world. Like if somebody has taken away my gamcha or my pen without asking me, I may get so upset with him that I may not talk to him for 15 years. It's possible. Because you are in your own imaginary world, and a grihastha thinks it is so silly. Kya koi problem hai kya? Because he is dealing with so many issues sometimes. So Devamrut Maharaj is saying that he once experienced one of his godbrothers was very upset with his temple president because he had given him a lot of service. And then he didn't talk to him, and then a lot of issues happened. And then Maharaj had to tell him, Prabhu, 35 years have passed since this incident. You're still carrying the grudges in your heart. I mean, it's ridiculous. So when we deal with, when we deal with the real issues, this material energy presence and the pain that we go through because of our attachments and the compromises that we have to make. So we become humble and we become sensitive and we learn to empathize with others. And for those who are not dealing with this harshness, this concept doesn't ring a bell. That's why His Holiness Radhana Swami Maharaj once told us in the Brahmachari class that Brahmacharis cannot understand Grihastha problem and Grihasthas cannot understand Brahmacharis problem. Just like a fish cannot understand the problem of the bird and the bird cannot understand the problem of the fish. Isn't it? But at the same time, one who is surrendered to Krishna, one who is really detached internally, he gets an aerial view. And he can see life regardless of the ashram. That's why some sannyasis, I hear Bhakti Vigyan Maharaj lectures and the amazing insights he gives on Grihastha ashram or Urmila Mataji's classes on renunciation. You know, it doesn't matter what ashram or what sex you belong to. If you have the principle of attachment to Krishna and detachment from material world, you get an aerial view towards life. At the same time, one who is facing dharma sankat or contradictions daily, humility, sensitivity, empathy, what Srila Prabhupada is talking about in today's purport, is extremely important. Because compromise and adjustment is a reality. Like, I'll give a simple example. I remember one devotee, he was asking, Prabhuji, my mother, I am in America with my wife and children, now they are growing up. And my parents are getting old and they are calling me to come to India. And they can't come to America. They don't want to come to America. But my wife and children are insisting that we stay here only. So what should I do? This is a classic example of dharma sankat. You can't say this is right, that is wrong. See, Lord Ram loved his wife, Mother Sita. Anybody has any doubts on this? If you have doubts, read Aranyakand. The way Lord Ram is lamenting when Sita was kidnapped by Ravana, you will be like amazed the way he is crying and wailing. He looks at the trees and he sees Sita is everywhere and he laughs, he cries, he goes through such intense emotions. There is chapter after chapter where Lord Ram's intense attachment for Mother Sita is seen. So much so that his father had 365 wives, Dasharatha Maharaj, but Ram married only one wife. He could have easily, as a Kshatriya, he could have had more than one wife. But he was so attached to Mother Sita that he didn't take any other wife. He was totally attached. But yet, when the 8 ministers Sabha, when they came and told Lord Ram that lot of citizens are talking about, you know, your wrong decision and all those complications and the controversy that happened, then Lord Ram had to resolve it with a heavy heart by sending Mother Sita to Valmiki's ashram. He didn't banish her. He sent her to ashram where there is shelter. Mother Sita got shelter in Valmiki's ashram. So now people criticize Ram that he was an extremely bad husband. So as a husband, he may have done a mistake. Okay, let us assume. As a husband, it is wrong. But he also was a king. He also had kingly duties. How many of us here I've been a king? How many of us have been a chief minister or prime minister? What do we know about responsibility towards citizens? We have no idea. So you have to understand, see, we all get what? In life, if an exam of 100 marks, we may get 30, some of us may get 35, we may just pass. Lord Ram is Purna Purushottam Bhagavan, but still he gets 97, 98, not 100 out of 100, because he has done something with Mother Sita. He had to send her. So that is dharma sankat. What to do? Mother Sita, when Lord Ram told her to remain in palace, then he was going to forest. You can read Ayodhya Kand. Mother Sita scolds Ram that I want to come to the forest. I think my father has married me to a woman who is in the dress of a man. That's what she tells. Although she's not a timid woman. She's assertive. She scolds Ram. So, but same Sita accepts with a heavy heart and pain, of course, this decision of Lord Ram, because as a king, it's very complicated. It's not simple. It's not black and white. So similarly, this Prabhuji was in America. Dharma Sankat means when two dharma conflicts. Dharma of son, dharma of husband, dharma of father. See, dharma word, what does it mean? It comes from the root dhatu, dhr dhatu. Dhr is sustenance. So this universe is sustained because of certain laws and principles. And when we align our lives to these principles, there is dharma. There is peace and harmony in this universe. Like a student, when he is studying sincerely, he is practicing dharma. When a mother is taking care of her child, there is dharma. But life, we have two or three roles, sometimes five roles. So there is dharma sankat, there is conflict of dharma. Then what do? We do these two things, use our intelligence and understand what is Krishna's will. See, one devotee, he was growing in his career and he came to a stage where he had to give next 5 years extra 7 to 8 hours in office. Only for the next 5 years. If he would do that, his career would really shoot up and rest of his life would be smooth. But that very point of time in his life, his daughter went through serious sickness and she needed a lot of attention from the father and affection. So now he was in a dilemma. So should I spend more time with my daughter or should I give myself for the next 5 years more in my work? These are two dharmas conflicting, right? So of course it is easy for us to sit on the Vyasasana and say that this is right, this is wrong. You should do this, you should not do that. But reality is different. Sometimes people say, "Arey, experience hai, seen so many devotees ka experience. Just learn from those experiences and avoid all making mistakes." It's not so easy because it is true that experience will save us from wrong decisions and mistakes. That is one reality. But another reality is experience comes from making mistakes and taking wrong decisions. That is also a reality. So in that sense, it is not a mistake. In that sense, it is not a wrong decision because you are learning, you are growing, you are evolving. J.K. Rowling, one of the most famous, she wrote Harry Potter series. So when she was giving the convocation address at Harvard, she made one statement which just struck me so powerfully. I'll just repeat it. I'm paraphrasing it, but this is what she said. She said, "You cannot succeed in life without failing unless you live so carefully that you may as well have not lived at all. And in that sense, you have failed at the outset." Did you get it? I'll repeat. You cannot succeed in life without failing unless you live so carefully that you may not have lived at all. And in that, and if you do that, you have failed at the outset only. So therefore, we have to trust devotees as they are struggling, evolving, making wrong decisions, struggling, taking consultation of devotees. But sometimes we still make mistakes. But we have to give that space and that assurances. I remember once I was giving a class. I spoke about one grihastha couple who are very sincere in their bhakti. They get up at 2:30 in the morning. They complete their rounds before 5 o'clock. And then they attend Mangalarati. Then the whole day they do temple seva and night 10 o'clock, 9:30 they sleep. Full devotional service. Very inspiring. I told their entire story. After 1 week, one Prabhuji came to me and he said, "Prabhuji, our family life has got disturbed because after you gave this example." I said, "What happened?" Inspiring example. He said, "Prabhuji, it is inspiring. But you know, every year I and my wife and our children, we all go on a vacation to either Europe or America for 1 month, 2 months because you know, both of us are working and that is the only time we get when we connect with each other, when we can spend a lot of time. And it is very good trip. Every year we are having this trip. But after you gave the class, my wife is saying, this is all Maya. So we should not go. We should only do bhakti now. So then I was confused. And then they were really going through some challenges. So how to resolve this? So then they came to me and I said, Mataji, Prabhuji, I will tell you the other side of the story. Now you decide what to do. What is the other side of the story? I said, see, on the Vyasasana, we have a mandate. We are supposed to glorify pure devotional service. So I will only speak pure devotional service. But there is another aspect to this entire story, which you have to use your common sense, like Arjuna used in Ashwatthama's case. And what is that? I said, this Prabhuji and Mataji, they do all this what I told you, 11 months in a year. And 1 month, they go on a vacation to one particular place. There they stay in a very nice resort. And 1 month, they just spend time with each other. They connect with each other. They go on long walks in the beach. They read Krishna book to each other. They chant together. And they connect with each other. And then they come back and do a lot of devotional service. For then, next day, I got the phone call from the Prabhuji saying, we have booked our tickets. We are going. So, like, understanding what Krishna really wants. See, Guru will give us Krishna. Preachers will speak about Krishna. We will represent the parampara. But one has to understand in his own life, according to his own needs, how to apply these principles with these two understanding. One is, what does Krishna really want from me? And second, use your God-given intelligence. But devotees have a genuine doubt. Prabhuji, Maya is very powerful. Maya, if we do like this, Maya will take us away. Therefore, I'll repeat this point. We have to apply the principles according to our capacity. So there is a principle. Sense gratification is bad. We should give up sense gratification. Now, how to apply this principle is different for different people. Like, light dispels darkness. Have you heard this statement? Light removes darkness. What is that saying? Godhead is light. Nescience is darkness. Where there is Godhead, there is no nescience, Prabhupada said. So this is a simple principle. Light removes darkness. Now, look at the way different people apply this principle. Sun God. How does sun apply this? When sun arises, what happens to darkness? So sun is following the principle of light removes darkness. But at what extent? Now, there may be pitch darkness in your room at night. And you may take a candle and you may light a candle. Now, candle has also followed the same principle. A matchstick has followed the same principle. Light removes darkness. But the capacity of the candle and the capacity of the sun is completely different. Right? Similarly, you know, don't waste any time. Just absorb in devotional service 24 hours a day. The six Goswamis did that. And we are supposed to follow the footsteps of six Goswamis. But Srila Prabhupada also said, if we imitate the six Goswamis, we will die. Right? So, therefore, especially for people who are in a situation like Arjuna or Draupadi, we all want approval of Krishna. We want to please Krishna. Otherwise, you know, we'll get depressed if you're not pleasing the Lord. Therefore, we have to understand the principles and apply it according to our capacity using our God-given intelligence. Otherwise, we will always feel inadequate in Krishna consciousness because the standards are very high. So we have to use our intelligence and apply it individually. Because let us accept, we all have material attachments, right? So if you have material attachments, then there will be suffering. We all go through suffering because of the material attachments. And that just like attachment is real, the pain and suffering is also real because of attachment. So there is attachment, there is detachment. In between, there is the process of detachment. And during that process, we have to be kind to ourselves and others and empathetic, understand, sensitive. Like, you know, we say, oh, mother loves the child the most. Right? We say this sometimes. And we give the example of child love, the mother, pure devotional service, love for Krishna. We give the example of the child, mother's love for the child and all that. But harsh ground reality, sometimes there is love, but there is frustration also in motherhood. You know, sometimes parents fight There is a newborn baby crying and the parents are fighting. Why we have this child? We should not have had this child. Now, does that mean they don't love the child? But the reality of dealing with that, that's painful. That's why they have postpartum depression. You know, mothers go through depression after delivering the child also. That's a reality. So we are expert in knowing what should be done, what should not be done, what is good, what is bad. But we also need to know what is ideal we know, but what is the reality? Like one devotee, he and his wife and children were serving this Prabhuji's father for 10 years. He was bedridden and he was also mentally challenged. And they served him so sincerely and they were so attached to him. And when he passed away, they were crying and they were sad. But that Prabhuji told me, Prabhuji, I am in depression now because I'm actually feeling guilty because I'm feeling relief after my father's passing away. Because the reality is how the mind tricks you. The mind is giving the feeling of relief. Because it was not easy serving his father. They sincerely served with dedication. And there was attachment, there was crying, everything. But there was also a sense of relief. And the same mind then makes you feel guilty for feeling relief. How the mind is tricky. How the mind makes our life miserable in this material world. You know, like in cricket, when we were young, Australia was very famous for sledging. So first they would put a bouncer on the batsman. The batsman would get shaken and he would get hit and he would fall. And after he falls, the same fielders and bowlers would come and tell him, you are a useless fellow, can't even hold a bat. And they would sledge him. So when you're hit by a bouncer, that is bad. But worse is when the sledging happens. Similarly, the mind gives us some unholy thought, or the mind makes us betray our values. That is enough damage. But the actual damage happens after that, when the mind plunges you into a pool of depression. So therefore, we need to be attentive and prayerful in our practices. And as Srila Prabhupada says in today's purport, sensitive, kind, humble, empathetic. Because we will make mistakes and we will grow and we will walk and learn through them. I remember once Ravindra Swarup Prabhu was asked, Prabhuji, you know, this smartphone culture has started now. Everybody is having smartphone. It is such a big distraction. So what is the formula for right use of smartphones? And Ravindra Swarup Prabhu, he gave a beautiful answer. He said, most of the things in Krishna consciousness, including how to use smartphone, you learn by trial and error. Trial and error matlab, you use, you learn, you slip, you understand, oh, this is too much, this is too less. This is for preaching, this is not for preaching. Our problem is we look for, quick fix solutions, a magic pill. Prabhuji, give me something. But there is no shortcut for purification. We have to go through. But still, there is a very important way to understand how we can. Now the question arises, these are the two principles, right? One is using our intelligence. And secondly, understanding Krishna's will. Now let us say you have a genuine question. How do we know what is Krishna's will? Or how do we use our intelligence? So for that, Yoga Sutras explain, Jai Sri Sri Radha Gopinath Bhagavan Ki Jai. Yoga Sutras explain that there are four ways by which we learn things in life, or we understand, or we get knowledge through four steps. So what we need to do is, if we are put in a situation like Arjuna and we have to take the right decision, then we need to understand which of these four levels we are in terms of understanding of life or in terms of knowledge. And we need to up our standard. We need to upgrade. Wherever we are, we need to upgrade. Okay. So what is the first level? First level is we learn through impulse, instinct. Like, you don't have to use intelligence for that. Instinct is like, you know, if an ant comes or some fly comes on your shoulder, so immediately you will use the right hand and drive it away. Now you don't start thinking, analyzing, asking, consulting, counseling. Ant has come, instinctively you remove it. Or you're crossing the road, you see traffic, cars are coming. You instinctively know when to stop, when to go, how to do. So that is, instinct drives us. And that's how animals live. So many human beings also live by instinct. But there is a higher level. See, impulse or instinct and senses is one level. So, for first level of getting knowledge is what? instinct, where our senses drive us, right? But there's a second level where it is not the senses, where it is superior knowledge or scriptures, and where it is not instinct, but it is intelligence. We understand, hey, what is this happening? Why is this happening? Oh, what should I do? And then we use our superior intelligence, what we have learned from elders or from wisdom books. There is a very nice quote I had read many years ago, that between stimulus means what happens to us, and our response to it. Between the stimulus and response, there is a space. And in that space lies our freedom. And in that freedom lies our growth, success, and happiness. So we all have this situation, we all are put in this situation where we need to use our intelligence. And that time, our knowledge that we acquire from superiors, from wisdom books, it all comes handy. Most people live in these two levels of knowledge. But there is a third, which is very, very important. That is knowledge based not on simply instinct or intelligence, but intuition. Or it is not simply based on your senses or, you know, superior books, but it is based on the soul. So what is intuition? Intuition is, I don't know if you have experienced, sometimes when you are hearing something, reading something, or you are sitting, suddenly you know something. And there is no logic, but you are convinced, and you just, you know, it's like what we say, realization. It's like you know this is right. It is not opposite of intelligence. It is not contradictory to intelligence, but it is beyond intelligence. You just know it. It is basically digested knowledge. Whatever you have been knowing, it is digested when you get intuition. Means there is no explanation. You just know it. It's a flash, it comes. It comes in a flash. This is right. This is wrong. You should not do this. You should do this. This is the way it is. And you just know it. You know, intelligence, when we read scriptures for a long time, that knowledge, that understanding, that our intelligence gets purified, and our intelligence gets us to the door of intuition and then leaves us. Means we know it. Right now, for most of us, we are stuck at the first two levels of knowledge. We act according to instinct, or we act according to our intelligence. So although our intelligence is getting purified when we read scriptures, but at the same time, because we are conditioned by our own anarthas, our own samskaras, it is at the level of I. When I am reading, I want to know. It is I level. That's why intuition is also connected to what we know in the past. Therefore, we need to upgrade to the fourth level of knowledge, where knowledge is not simply based on our instinct or intelligence, or also it is not based on intuition, but it is based on being an instrument in the Lord's hand. It is not simply based on senses or scriptures, or it is not simply based on the level of the soul. It is based on the level of the super soul. That is why when in Journey Home we read His Holiness Radhana Swami Maharaj, when he was constantly praying as a young boy, Richard, he heard a voice which told him, go to India. He wanted to be an instrument in the hands of the Lord, universe, God, divinity, whatever you call it. So as we evolve in our spiritual lives, at some point of time, we need to place our fragile lives in the hands of the Supreme Lord. So when we are reading scriptures, we could either read them from my point of view, from my space. You know, I want to understand what scripture says as a solution to my problem. Let me read. That is all I space. But when I read Srimad Bhagavatam in the mood that please reveal to me what is best for me to serve you, my dear Lord, then I am becoming an instrument in the Lord's hand. And then the revelation that comes to me is at the fourth level of knowledge, because I am being guided to be an instrument in the Lord's hand. So that's how we evolve. That's how we can act like Arjuna. We can improvise. Of course, along with studying the scriptures and chanting at this level, we can also have to do the needful. You know, we also need blessings of others. We need to be practical. Then if we do all this, then with all our slips and struggles that we go through in our lives, when it really matters, Krishna will guide us. Krishna will protect us. As the Puranas explain, Yadi vatadi doshena madbhakta mam nachas smaret aham smarami madbhakta nahami paramam gatim. Because of the imbalance of air and so many complications, my devotee may not remember me at the time of death, Krishna says. But aham smarami madbhakta, but I will remember that devotee because he has sincerely struggled. He has sincerely applied this principle and I will bring him back to me. So therefore, we need to take our devotional service to the next level. Instead of simply living at the level of instinct and our intelligence, we need to absorb in scriptures and sharpen our connection with ourselves, the soul, and also understand the Lord's will by paying submissive oral reception to the scriptures. You know, sometimes when we read scriptures, we have this idea that just tell me what to do. You know, we want simple solutions, black and white. It's not like that. Like I'll give an example. If you go to these military academies, war colleges, you know, in a war college, they teach you all the battles. They will teach you Napoleonic Wars. They will teach you Battle of Somme, the Second World War, First World War. All the wars are studied there in the military academy. They have a proper 3-year, 4-year course. They have case studies. They study, they have exam, and they pass the exam. And then they become commandos, fighters, right? National security guards. So now when they go to fight the terrorists, like, you know, 13 years ago when the terrorists attacked Mumbai, these commandos went with their gun to fight the terrorists. No, they did not take their notebook and they didn't say, "Arey, which battle? Oh, this, we copy paste some battle solution for that battle they won. So we can take that as a formula and apply it here." No, they had studied sincerely. That knowledge has become part of their being. And then they trust their gut, they trust their intuition, they've assimilated that knowledge and they improvise in that particular situation based on the accumulated knowledge. And then they fight the war because every situation is unique, every battle is unique. Similarly, every day our challenges come in unique ways. So how to apply Srimad Bhagavatam in our life, how to apply Bhagavad Gita requires improvisation. So when we have the culture of using our intelligence and surrendering to Krishna's will and praying to Krishna to reveal to us what is His divine will, then we will be able to act like Arjuna, pleasing. Arjuna successfully pleased both parties. He pleased Draupadi and Yudhishthira Maharaj and also Bhima and Krishna. So this is the way we practice. This is the way we adjust and compromise without deviating from the principles of Krishna consciousness. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Ram, Hare Ram, Ram Ram, Hare Hare. We can take some questions or comments if we have. Yes, Prabhu. There is a microphone coming your way.
Hare Krishna, Praji. Thank you so much for the wonderful class, Praji. And especially, I really relished the point of the four levels of instinct, intelligence, intuition, and then instrument in the hand of Lord. Praji, regarding this point only, in the context of intuition, I had a question that can we explain our intuition to others? Because sometimes we decide something based on our intuition. We just know that this is right and this has to be done. But then there can be conflicts created, and especially, you know, family, parents, they can say, "Why you are doing this thing?" Whereas we just know that, you know, this is to be done. We don't have a proper explanation for that, but it has to be done. So is it explainable, or and then how to resolve this kind of conflict that is created?
It depends. Not everything everybody can explain. Some people are good in communication. Some people are not great communicators. It's a skill. As I said, intuition is not opposite of intelligence. It can be intelligently, you know, you can explain it if you have the ability. Like, you know, one devotee was saying in their group discussion, he was from a very premier management institute. So they had a case study given of some 25 people. The aeroplane, there was an air crash, and they are all stranded in a desert. And different things are lying with them. Some, you know, there are some glass, there is some toothpaste, all that. And you are stuck in that desert, and your plane has crashed. So first, individually, you have to decide which of these 25 things is most important you will pick up. If you have to pick up only one, you have to grade. So after individually they have graded, then they have to collectively discuss, and the group has to give the grading what they think is best. So many individuals, they had the correct grading. But in the group, they could not convince the group. So one particular friend of mine, I know him. So what happened? He chose the mirror. Intuitively, he knew that mirror is the most important thing I have to grab. But he couldn't explain why, how, what. And everybody else chose it as in the last. So individually, he got the highest marks. But his group was very average. And then the professor asked, but his score is highest. Which is the first item you chose? He said, mirror. So, and if you choose mirror, you get some 100 points or something. So then when they revealed, but why you couldn't convince the group? He said, I couldn't convince, but... And the professor said, you are right. You are bang on. That is the most important thing to choose. But why you couldn't convince? He said, no, I'm not a communicator. But I know this is the most important. And then the professor revealed that if you have the mirror with you, because your plane has crashed, the search planes will now come. Helicopters will come searching. So if you have a mirror, because it is broad daylight, you can reflect the sunshine through the mirror, and you can send a signal. Now, but this student, he did not know all these logical explanations, but he intuitively knew that this is what has to be done. So what I'm saying, many times, some people are not communicators. Some people can. It's a skill. So if you want to develop the skill of communicating your intuition, which you are convinced of, right, then you can practice what is called as journal writing. Where you can simply write what you're feeling now, what you're experiencing right now. One of the types of journaling is writing what is happening now. Right now, my left shoulder is paining. I'm feeling a little warm. It is, you know, basically whatever is happening around you when you write, your awareness improves. So when your awareness improves, your clarity improves. And when you have more clarity, you are able to communicate. So like that. So this is the way we can communicate our intuition. Any other questions or comments?
Hare Krishna.
Yes, I can't see you. Prabhuji ka question leta hun, then I'll take your question. Yes.
Prabhuji, apne abhi jo bataya ki Bhagwan Krishna jo hai, ki jab Draupadi ke paas putro ko Ashwatthama ne mara, to Bhagwan Krishna ne unke jo Guruji jo thi, Sandipani Muni, unka jo ladka tha, wo bhi mar gaya tha, to Bhagwan ne la ke diya. उसी प्रकार से देवकी के जो छह पुत्र थे, लास्ट मोमेंट में देवकी ने बताया कि हमारे जो छह पुत्र गए हैं तो आप ला सकते हैं, तो उनको भी छह पुत्र लाके दिया। तो भगवान कृष्णा ने द्रौपदी के पांच पुत्रों को क्यों नहीं लाके दिया?
पता नहीं मुझे मुझे नहीं पता आपने अच्छा क्वेश्चन पूछा है, पर क्या है ना, पास्ट टाइम्स में ना क्वेश्चन का आंसर नहीं होता बहुत बार. फिलोसफी में क्वेश्चन आंसर हो सकता है, पास्ट टाइम में भगवान ने ऐसा क्यों किया, अभी ऐसा क्यों नहीं किया. अभी अभी एक भिखारी बैठा है रोड पे, वो बोल रहा है, वो दोनों भिखारी बात कर रहे हैं, बोल रहे हैं वो अंबानी ने वो कंपनी क्यों नहीं खरीदा, वो भी खरीदना चाहिए था उसको. अरे हम भिखारी, हमारे क्या औकात है क्या पूछने का कि वो अंबानी ने ऐसा क्यों किया वैसा क्यों किया. तो उसी प्रकार भगवान लीला में क्या करते हैं, क्यों, उनका एक बड़ा प्लान रहता है, तो शुद्ध भक्त समझ सकते हैं. तो बट ऑनेस्टली मुझे पता नहीं, अगर किसी को आंसर पता है तो बता दीजिए प्रभु जी का. एनीबडी नोज द आंसर? सी, मेरा अंडरस्टैंडिंग ऐसा है, पास्ट टाइम्स में लॉर्ड का एक विजन है, लॉर्ड का एक प्लान है, लॉर्ड एग्जीक्यूट करते हैं अपने भक्तों के माध्यम से. और एग्जैक्टली टू अंडरस्टैंड एवरीथिंग व्हाई द लॉर्ड डज सिस्टमैटिकली, आई डोंट नो ऑनेस्टली इन दिस पास्ट टाइम, बट इफ समबडी नोज कैन आंसर. इज दैट ओके? सी, एक बात क्लियर है, भगवान भी जब मटेरियल वर्ल्ड में आते हैं, उनको भी सब अप्रूवल नहीं मिलता, सब उनकी भी बातों को सब स्वीकार नहीं करते. यदा च पार्थ प्रहित सभायां जगद्गुरो यानि जगाद कृष्ण नतानि पुंसाम अमृतान यानि राजोरु मेने क्षत पुण्य लेशा। तो विदुर मैत्रेय संवाद में आता है कि देखिए कृष्ण का पोजीशन देखिए, यदा च पार्थ प्रहित सभायां, पार्थ ने कहा कृष्ण तुम जाओ शांति दूत बन के जाओ, थोड़ा कौरवों को अक्कल समझाओ उनको। तो कृष्ण आते हैं शांति दूत बन के कौरवों की सभा में, फिर देखिए क्या होता है। यदा च पार्थ प्रहित सभायां जगत गुरु यानी जगाद कृष्ण, ये जगत गुरु है, कृष्ण पूर्ण पुरुषोत्तम भगवान है और सभा में सबको समझा रहे हैं कि अरे पांडवों को 5 गांव तो दे दो। नतानि पुंसाम अमृतान यानी, कृष्ण के जो वचन थे वो अमृत जैसा था कुछ लोगों के लिए, जैसे भीष्म बैठे थे वहां पर विदुर, उनके लिए अमृतवाणी थी। नतानि पुंसाम अमृतान यानी, बट जो ईर्ष्यालु लोग थे उधर, राजोरु मेने क्षत पुण्य लेशा, उनका पुण्य लेश कुछ भी नहीं था, वो और ईर्ष्यालु बन गए। तो भगवान को भी अप्रूवल नहीं मिला है मटेरियल वर्ल्ड में, क्या है अभी अभी आप बोलोगे अरे भगवान कन्विंस नहीं कर सकते क्या? वो हार्ट में परमात्मा जैसे हैं तो, बट कृष्णा हैज हिज ओन। सो व्हाई कृष्णा डज व्हाट ही डज, इसीलिए सम थिंग्स एटलीस्ट यू नो आचार्य डेफिनेटली मस्ट हैव गिवन परपोर्ट एनालिसिस किया होगा कहीं बुक्स में होगा, बट मेनी पास्ट टाइम वी जस्ट एक्सेप्ट हरी बोल करके, इट्स अ पास्ट टाइम, बट वी अंडरस्टैंड। अभी कृष्णा देखिए ना, अभी कृष्णा भगवान है, भगवान को कोई मार सकता है, बट कृष्ण को जरा ने शूट किया एरो एंड कृष्णा वेंट बैक राइट। मतलब लाइक हाउ वी डाई एक्सटर्नली, आप देखिए भगवान भौतिक जगत कैसे छोड़ के गए। तो इसीलिए सुखदेव गोस्वामी वॉर्न करते हैं भागवतम में, 12th कैंटो जब एंड होता है ना तो एक श्लोक आता है, वही मुझे याद नहीं है, मर्त्ये न ये गुरु सुतम यमलोक नीतम। एनीबडी रिमेंबर दिस ब्यूटिफुल वर्स, मर्त्ये न ये गुरु सुतम यमलोक नीतम त्वाम चान यच्छरण द परमास्त्र दग्धम जिज्ञान्तकान्तकमपि शमसावनीश किं स्वावने स्वरनयन मृगयं सदेहम। सुखदेव गोस्वामी बोलते हैं कृष्ण को कोई मार सकता है? कृष्ण क्या हमारे और आपके जैसा मरते हैं? कोई तर्क कर सकता है कि भगवान तो भगवान को भी मार दिया किसी ने? तो 4 आर्ग्यूमेंट देते हैं सुखदेव गोस्वामी, वो बोलते हैं मर्त्येना, जो गुरु उनके गुरु के बच्चे पुत्र जो मर गए थे, मर्त्येना ये गुरु सुतम यमलोक नीतम, तो जो आपने बताया वो यमलोक से अपने गुरु के बच्चे को वही रूप में लेके आए, वही शरीर में लेके आए। सोचिए भगवान का पावर, उनके गुरु के बच्चे को जिस बॉडी में डेथ हुआ था वही बॉडी में वापस लेके आए। मर्त्ये न ये गुरु सुतम यमलोक नीतम त्वाम चान यच, अरे तुम परीक्षित महाराज, वो परीक्षित महाराज को बोल रहे हैं सुखदेव गोस्वामी, त्वाम चान यच शरण द परमास्त्र दग्धम, आपको परमास्त्र सबसे पावरफुल अस्त्र ब्रह्मास्त्र से आपको जला दिया था और आपको वापस लेके आए कृष्ण। और तीसरा जिज्ञेन्तकांतकम अपि शमसावनीश, जिज्ञे वो विजय हो गए, अंतकांतकम जो सबका अंत करते हैं यम सबका अंत करते हैं शिवजी, अंतकांतकम अंत करते हैं यमदूत, यमदूतों को हराते हैं शिवजी, उनको अंतक अंतकम कहा गया है और उनको आपने हराया बानासुर के युद्ध में। जो एजेंट्स ऑफ डेथ को हराते हैं शिवजी, उनको आपने हराया। जिज्ञान्तकान्तकम् अपि शम असावनीश, सो दैट कृष्ण कैन ही बी इनकेपेबल ऑफ एनीथिंग। और लास्ट एग्जांपल देते हैं, किम स्वावने स्वरनयन मृगयम सदेहम, अरे हाउ कैन ही नॉट प्रोटेक्ट हिमसेल्फ, मृगयम सदेहम, जिस जरा ने उनके पैर पर एरो फेंका और उनको सो कॉल्ड मार डाला, उसको उसी शरीर में भगवत धाम भेजा। अभी पहला वर्ड बताया, गुरु के बच्चे को उसी शरीर में वापस लेके आए मृत्यु लोक से इधर, और उनके जिसने शूट किया उसको उसी शरीर में इस लोक से भगवत धाम भी भेज दिया। तो 4 एग्जांपल देते हैं, अपने गुरु के बच्चे को लेके आए कृष्ण, दूसरा एग्जांपल देते हैं शिवजी को हराया, तीसरा परीक्षित महाराज का, और चौथा जरा का। तो फिर बोलते हैं कि सो दिस कृष्णा इज नॉट ऑर्डिनरी, ही इज परफॉर्मिंग पास्ट टाइम्स to execute his big plan like that. Okay? Hare Krishna. Last question we'll take. Yes, Prabhuji.
हे कृष्ण
प्रभु जी आई हैव वन क्वेश्चन दैट हाउ टू डिफरेंशिएट बिटवीन वॉइस ऑफ परमात्मा एंड इंट्यूशन
इट्स अ लूप इट इज नॉट यू नो इट इज लाइक it is not one above the other it becomes a circle everything it's aligned now when we are not connected to the lord this becomes a technical question but when we are connected to the lord this is harmonized see life is not simply a problem to be solved you know this question comes from the space of wanting to solve some problem Life is not simply a problem to be solved. It is also a reality to be experienced. So when you enter that space, then this is harmonized. Right now we are thinking, oh, is my mind saying this or is Paramatma saying? That means this question itself reveals that we are trying to quantify everything. We are stuck at the bottom of the ladder of abstraction. You know, we want everything specific, but in life we also need to go up in the ladder of abstraction. We need to understand abstract concepts. Some things are not put in black and white numbers. You know, just like if you say vehicle is a very abstract word. But if you say car, then it is little less abstract. If you say red color, Hyundai, Santro, that is more specific. So in life also, there are certain concepts we learn at the bottom of the ladder of abstraction some things at the middle some things at the top so when we say humility is abstract but when we say follow authority that is more specific but when we say do these two things and don't do these two things that is more specific so Srila Prabhupada has given us very specific instructions but has also given us abstract like he has told us follow four regulative principles don't do this don't do that But it is also said, one should cry for the Lord like a baby cries for mother. Have you heard this? One should chant. How to chant Hare Krishna? Prabhupada said, we should cry like a baby cries for mother. So we should ask this question in the class. How to cry? Three steps of crying. First sit like this. Then how do we cry? It is very individual, right? Crying for the Lord is very, very personal. It's abstract. But Srila Prabhupada knew we will get confused. So Srila Prabhupada gave us something practical about chanting also. He said, listen. Listen is very practical. That's why Srila Prabhupada gave us prayer. He made chanting Hare Krishna as both prayer as well as meditation. See, what is prayer? Prayer is simple. You come in front of the Lord. You pray pray to the Lord. Prayer means Bhagavatam prayers have these four qualities. Praising the Lord. Krishna, you are so beautiful. Begging forgiveness from the Lord. Krishna, I did this mistake. Please forgive me. Or thanking the Lord. Krishna, please, you have given me so many gifts. No, yata rishikesha kalena devaki. All that is thanking the Lord. Or asking from the Lord. Requesting, Krishna, please give me this. It's all prayer. We all know prayer. We all have heard about prayer, types of prayers, all that. But Srila Prabhupada also told us chanting Hare Krishna is a meditation. Meditation is... Prayer is talking to the Lord. Meditation is when we listen to the Lord. That's why many yogis, you know, they'll sit in the Himalayas, mountains. They listen to the universe. They listen to the voice of God. We make God listen to our prayers. That is great. But God also wants to tell us something. God also wants to tell us, you fool, do this or don't do this. How do we listen to the Lord's voice in the heart? So we listen. So Prabhupada said, listen to the holy name. Listen to your chanting. So when we listen... Then our prayer transforms into meditation because then God talks to us. Unfortunately, when practicing sadhana bhakti, most of us, we want to control Krishna. We want to figure out everything and we want, even prayers are like, you know, we want to figure out everything and bracket Krishna into this and I want to do everything like this. I want to be perfect. But that is not prayer. That is not bhakti. Bhakti is also to listen to the Lord. Lord has something for us. Like if in a relationship, a boy and girl love each other very much. Premi, premika ka bahut pyar hai. Theek hai? But in the relationship, when the lover says, I love my beloved so much that I talk to her whole day. I keep telling her everything. But do you listen to her? No, I only keep talking. How long will that relationship last? In a relationship, यू स्पीक टू योर लवर एंड यू ऑल्सो लिसन. लिसनिंग इज एन इक्वल इंपॉर्टेंस इफ नॉट मोर, राइट? यू एग्री? So similarly, in our relationship with Krishna, it is not that we simply speak with Krishna and tell him everything. We also have to devote time to listen. So when we take part in Sankirtan, we are dancing in the Kirtan. We are one part of a big plan. We are allowing ourselves to be used as an instrument. So that is also equally important. That's why even in this world, in relationships, you know, we need to not simply look at our relationship with Krishna in terms of my needs, my understanding, my comfort. We also need to know certain things I will never know. Certain things Krishna has to reveal. You know, there is a very famous author, Punjabi author, Amrita Pritam. She is, I think, the first lady to win the Gyanapith Award for literature in India. So she's written many novels. So she said, why there is complication between relationship between man and woman? शी सेड आदमी और औरत के रिश्ते में उलझने क्यों होती हैं? क्योंकि आदमी ने औरत के साथ सोना सीखा है, उसके साथ जागना नहीं सीखा. ही सेज मैन हैज लर्न्ड हाउ टू स्लीप विद द वुमन बट हैज नॉट लर्न्ड हाउ टू वेक अप विद हर. इन द सेंस, यू नो, दैट्स व्हाई आवर प्रभु जी, द लॉट ऑफ जपा इज इस्कॉन गुरु, महात्मा प्रभु, ही सेड वी हैव टू अंडरस्टैंड इट इज नॉट माई जपा. वेन वी आर चैंटिंग वी हैव टू नो दैट इट इज आवर जपा, यू नो. It is, it's, you are with Krishna. Similarly, we consider Krishna and the process of devotional service for my needs. And that's why these questions come. But when we surrender to Krishna's will, Krishna, let me be an instrument in your hand. You use me the way you want. Then these things, concepts are harmonized. Is that okay? Thank you very much. Hare Krishna. ग्रंथराज श्रीमद्भागवतम की जय. श्रील प्रभुपाद की जय.